risen Christ is with us. Amen? Amen. Let's stand together as we give praise to God. The risen Christ is with us. Good morning and welcome to Memorial United. I'm Ron Beaton, one of the pastors. What a gift it is to be with you as we worship God today and celebrate resurrection, even in the midst of the season of Lent, as we continue to reflect on our need for God's grace and journey with Christ to the cross. I want to extend a special welcome to anybody who's a guest with us today. If you are a guest, we hope that you'll fill out a Connect card from the seat back pocket in front of you or from the attendance pad as it gets passed down the row. But we're particularly glad that you're with us today, and it's just a real joy. We've got a gift for you on your way out the door. I want to welcome those who are joining us on our Facebook live stream. We're glad you're joining us today as well. If you want to get connected, you can go to our website, memorialumc.church, and click on the Give tab. Today is also another special day because Eliana Savage will be baptized today, and her family will be joining the church. So what a gift that will be today as well. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let's pray together. Almighty God, you alone can bring into order the unruly wills and affection of us sinners. Grant your people grace to love what you command and desire what you promise, that among the swift and varied changes of the world, our hearts may surely there be fixed, where true joys are to be found, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Before we continue with our service today, we've been continuing our sermon series on the seven deadly sins, which has been a real gift. Parents should know that this week may have a little bit more content than that may lead to some interesting questions when you get home, so just be aware of that. Let's stand together as we get, as we sing praise to God.
The question was raised as my conscience fell, a silly little lie. It didn't mean much, but it lingers in the corners of my mind. Still you call me to walk on the edge of this world, to spread my dreams and fly. But the future's so far, my heart is so frail, I think I'd rather stay inside. But you love me anyway. It's like nothing in life that I've ever known. Yes, you love me anyway. Oh, took more than my strength to simply be still, to seek but never find. All the reasons we change, the reasons I doubt, and why do loved ones have to die? But you love me anyway. It's like nothing in life that I've ever known. Yes, you love. Sweat from your brow, but you love me anyway. I am the nail in your wrist, but you love me anyway. Oh, I am Judas's kiss, but you love me anyway.
Let's pray. Almighty God, as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, may we hear with joy what you have to say to us today, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our gospel lesson comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, verses 21 through 37. You have heard it said of those of ancient times, you shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment. But I say to you that if you're angry with a brother or a sister, you will be liable to judgment. If you insult a brother or a sister, you will be liable to the council. And if they say, you fool, you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you're offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you're on the way to court with him, or your accuser may hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. Truly, I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard it said that you shall not commit adultery, but I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out, throw it away. It's better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off, throw it away. It's better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to go to hell. It was also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that anyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of unchastity, causes her to commit adultery, and whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard it said that to those of ancient times, you shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by earth, for it is the footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let your word be yes, yes, or your no, no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
any 6th through 12th graders would like to go to Sunday school, you can follow Jean to the youth basement.
In the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you may be seated. Amen. So last week, during announcements, I mentioned that when I was in high school, like, we had a pretty good group. When you combine the middle school and high school together, we averaged about 35 youth a week. But whenever the topic of sex came up, suddenly we'd have 55 or 60 in attendance, which for pubescent teenagers probably is not surprising. But based off of the crowd today, I see not much changes. You know, I don't think the book 50 Shades of Grey became a bestseller because of its literary value, right? Casey and I watched the first season of Bridgerton. I'm pretty sure it did not become popular because of the acting. Today we're wrapping up our sermon series on the seven deadly sins. The Desert Fathers, some Egyptian monastic monks that lived in the desert, they came up with this list of vices that even the most devout and faithful Christians would struggle with: pride, greed, wrath, envy, gluttony, sloth, and the one you've all been waiting for, lust. These capital vices are deadly because every one of them tests every one of us all the time, right? We fall into practicing these vices every day in some capacity. The Desert Fathers went into the arid wilderness to escape all of these worldly temptations, but even there, these vices could be found. It turns out that celibate monks living in the desert thought about sex too. Shocker, I know. The vice of lust was a challenge for them. And here we are in the year 2024, and we're not living in the desert. And we modern 21st century folks that we are, with the internet in our pocket at every turn, are not only tempted by the vice of lust, but we have it pushed on us from every single angle. Sex sells, after all. By the age of 16, 80% of teenagers have had multiple exposures to pornography. 80% by the age 16. When we read the first creation story from Genesis chapter 1, we discovered that God created us this way. Arousal, desire, unit of pleasure are a natural part of what it means to be a human, right? It's a part of God's good design for human beings. Sexuality is a good and great gift from God. In fact, there is an entire book of the Bible, right, that celebrates the romantic erotic escapades of a man and a woman. It's the book of Song of Solomon, which, interestingly enough, little Hebrew boys were not allowed to read until they got to a certain age. And yet the Apostle Paul, he seems to be a little bit more of a prude, right? He tells people who are unmarried and who are widowed, it's really best if you remain unmarried and celibate. But if you're going to marry, it's better to marry than to burn with passion, right? Now, I'm not, I can remember joining several of my friends when I was in high school at a Southern Baptist youth event growing up. And I remember leaving this event with the impression that lust is the chief sin of all sins, that any type of biological urges that you have must be suppressed at all cost, and then when you're married, all of the rules fall away, and you can do what you want as long as it's with your spouse. Now, I'm not sure that's the way I was supposed to leave feeling, but that was my impression. So with respect to my Baptist friends in Kennett, looking back, I'm not sure that that was really good theology. It certainly needs to be nuanced a little bit. I'm not sure exactly what I was supposed to leave feeling, but that was my impression. So Christians have this odd history with sexuality, and Christians have walked a really strange and weird line. And it seems that we've not always been successful on this tightrope, right? Walking successfully. So many non-Christians will look at the church more broadly and it seems that Christians are obsessed with the topic. I also have a hunch that the reason that so many United Methodists have spent time quarreling and arguing about homosexuality is because it's easier to focus on somebody else's sexual life than the hard work of doing, like, the difficult work of examining your own life. On one hand, it seems that we've spent way too much time arguing about sexuality, making it more important than it is, right? When you look at the overarching narrative of the Bible, it plays a pretty small part. The Bible spends a lot of time speaking out against greed, but you don't hear of any Methodist churches splitting over greed, fighting about that one. The Gospels are full of nonviolent language and teaching, and yet the Methodists have not split up over our wildly differing views on war and peace, right? It's not pacifists versus just war theorists that are splitting up. So why does the topic of sex seem to consume so much of the church's time and energy? And yet, right, on the other hand, it seems that we avoid talking about sex altogether, right? Or degrading sexual pleasures into meaningless triviality or a matter of biology only. We polite Midwestern Methodists know that we just don't talk about these things. I miss my grandparents every day of my life, but I am really glad they are not here to listen to my sermon today. So N.T. Wright, the famed Anglican bishop and New Testament theologian, he tells the joke about Moses coming down Mount Sinai with the Ten Commandments, you know, in each hand. And he says, I got good news and bad news. The good news is that we've whittled it down from 40 down to 10. The bad news is adultery is still on the list. Rebecca DeYoung says of sex that it has two purposes, and she's right, right? First, it unites people together in a very real and meaningful way. And second, occasionally it creates a new human being. So what's at stake here? Love and life. Love and life. Human relationships and human existence. So it's hard to see how one could ever overemphasize the theological importance of something like that, right? And if lust has the power to damage human love-giving and life-giving, then perhaps we cannot make too big of a deal about the destructive potential of sexual sin. So what is lust? I hold to lust as being reducing another human body as merely an object of pleasure rather than a human to be loved, right? So reducing another human body as merely an object of pleasure rather than a human to be loved. Pleasure and desire are good, right? But stripping them from a relationship is what makes it lust. Pornography, for example, seeks to allow people to seek pleasure without seeking full humanity. It privileges pleasure over relationships. Jesus took lust to a whole other level, right? He says, quote, to all you men, and of course he's addressing men here, like, if you've managed not to have an affair, if you looked at another woman with lust, it's the same thing. It's a shame, right, that he left women out of that. I guess they can get away with more than we men can. It's not true. Surely Jesus here doesn't think that daydreaming about a girl you met is the same as running away with her, right? Surely those things aren't the same. I've shared with this before in another sermon, but Jimmy Carter had a nice lead in the polls until an attempt to come across as a regular guy and not some prude, he had this fateful interview with Playboy magazine. When asked at the tail end of the interview the umpteenth question about whether his firmly held Baptist religious convictions would unduly influence his policy decisions in the White House, Carter began opining about grace and about sin. And then he said, quote, "I try not to commit a deliberate sin. I recognize that I'm going to do it anyhow because I'm a human and I'm tempted. And Christ set some almost impossible standards for us. Christ said, 'I tell you that anyone who looks on a woman with lust in his heart already committed adultery.' I've looked at a lot of women with lust. I've committed adultery in my heart many times. This is something that God recognizes I will do, and I have done it, and God forgives me for it." Jimmy Carter dropped 16 points in the polls the next week. Evangelicals were upset that he gave the interview in the first place, right? The Northerners on the East Coast thought he took Jesus way too seriously. Now, how dare he? How dare he say what everybody else knows is true? We all lust. Maybe it's not as common as it was when you were 18 years old, but we all do. And we all need God's grace. As we've thought about these seven vices over the last several weeks, we've discovered that there's areas of gray, right? It's not always black and white. A little pride in your basketball team, that's a good thing. But once that love of self supersedes love of God or neighbor, well, then we've got a problem, right? A little righteous anger, well, that's a good thing. It can be a catalyst for change in the world. But when that anger becomes wrath and our love turns away, we begin turning away, loving another person, right? That's when it becomes wrath. Lust is also gray. Sexual desire and passionate romance, these are good gifts from God. But when that desire becomes misdirected and love is distorted, watch out. Bishop Williman wrote, "The unabashed, innocent, mutual eroticism from the book of Song of Solomon is sex as it is meant to be. The sad, deadly results of King David's lust for Bathsheba is sex as we have made it." We've talked about the seven deadly sins and how they're really vices, right? Vices are the practices and habits that form us and shape us. And the danger of any of the seven is that they can become gateways to more egregious vices, right? It's not that they are particularly bad things, but they can give way to worse things, right? What makes the vice of lust so tricky is that we often practice it in secret, right? So what goes on in your brain or behind closed doors, well, that's nobody's business, we say. We have this problematic idea that lust is a victimless vice. But the truth is, lust doesn't stay in the mind or the bedroom. My law enforcement family members have said that lust is at the heart of almost every domestic phone call that they get. Even murders. How many parents of sexually active children are concerned about the collateral, reproductive, and health-related risks of lust? Just as each of the other vices can potentially give way to more serious problems, right? Wrath into violence, greed into theft, unchecked lust can give way to abuse, obscenity, adultery, deceit, debauchery. The list can go on. But as I said earlier, desire and pleasure, this is a gift from God. God wired us this way. So how do we remedy impulses to lust? There's like some real practical things to do, but what are the virtuous practices that remedy lust? Of the seven, I think this is actually the hardest to remedy. Historically, the understanding is the view that the virtue is chastity. Which sounds like some type of medieval contraption more than it does a realistic virtue. But chastity is not some game where we see how close we can get to the edge of the cliff without going over. Right? Chastity is not a rule book of do's and don'ts. But rather, de Young says, it's a pro-love lifestyle, and therefore a virtue one needs, whether single, married, old, young. Chastity's fundamental question is not how far on a date can I go without crossing some imaginary line where it becomes sinful, but rather, how can my life, my thoughts, my choices, my emotional responses, my conversations, my behavior make me a person who is best prepared to give and receive love in relationship with other people. It's practicing seeing other people not as objects of pleasure. To put another way, chastity is about making good friends and having loving friends in whom we find real beauty that mitigate the fleeting pleasure for distorted desires, right? So how do you combat lust? You make friends. You ask them good questions about who they are. Find communities of people with whom you celebrate robust relationships and friendships. Sex is for marriage because your spouse is the person with whom you share the fullness of humanity, at least in a good marriage, right? The physical, the emotional, the spiritual, the financial, you are fully with another human being in a good marriage. For so many, it appears like we think of God as this prude who's always looking over your shoulder, right? But one of the most intimate metaphors for our relationship with Jesus in Scripture is that of a husband and wife. The church is the bride of Christ. Jesus came to earth to dwell among us, to walk beside us, to be with us. God is with us even in our carnal, unimaginative, animalistic vices such as lust. God sees us as fully human, and God came to earth to be fully human, to be in this perfect relationship with us. And God is at relationship, God is at work to redeem every bit of us. People don't like to think about their pastor lusting. But although I may not be able to extinguish the fire of lust as it burns within me, I can dampen its flame, right? Not by myself, of course. If God can raise the dead, surely Jesus can deal with something so utterly natural and congenial to our nature as lust. And then with good friends, we find perfect love of God and perfect love of neighbor. Thanks be to God. Amen. As I said at the last service, I've never been more ready for a sermon to be over in my entire life. At this time, we're going to celebrate the gift of baptism. I invite the Savage family to come forward at this time. I'll let you find the right certificates. I'll let you all come right up this way, Tunde, Uche. Go ahead, come on up. Yeah, do it. This is what I signed up to do when I became a pastor. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We're incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All of this is God's gift offered to us without price. I present Eliana Savage for baptism, and I present Ushen and Tunde Savage for membership into Memorial United Methodist Church and into the United Methodist Church. And so now, hi there, Eliana. I ask both the parents and the sponsor, This is Tunde's mom, by the way. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, say, I do. Do you resist the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, say, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior? Do you put your whole trust in His grace and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened up to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, say, I do. And now I ask you, parents, will you nurture Eliana in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and your example, that she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly, and lead a Christian life? If so, say, I will.
I will.
And now I ask you, as the sponsor here today, will you support Eliana and encourage her in her Christian life? If so, say, I will. Thank you. Now, do all of you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? If so, say, we do. With God's help, will you proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ? Will you surround Eliana with a community of love and forgiveness, that she may grow in her trust of God and be found faithful in her service to others? Will you pray for her, that she may grow to be a true and faithful disciple of Jesus Christ, who walks in the way that leads to life? If so, say, we will. Now I ask all of you, do you believe in God the Father? Next slide there. Okay, then I'm going to do it this way. Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth? If so, say, I do. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried? He descended to the dead. On the third day, He rose again and ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty and will come again to judge the living and the dead. If so, say, we do. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting? If so, say, we do. Yes, we do. The Lord be with you. Let's pray. Eternal Father, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. In the fullness of time, you sent us Jesus, nurtured him in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all the nations. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and Eliana, who will receive it, to wash away her sin and clothe her in righteousness throughout her life, that dying and being raised with Christ, she may share in his final victory. And all of God's people said, amen. All right, Eliana, you ready for this? Hi. Hi. Hi, sweetheart. Hi. Oh, my. Oh, my. Eliana, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Eliana, may the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born of water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's welcome our newest sister in Christ.
It's so good.
That's for you.
That's for you.
Yeah. There you go.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right, Tunde. Let's say we got all those, yes. Okay. Tunde and Ushin are coming to join this congregation as well. They're transferring in from another denomination at another church. I'm so glad that they found their way here. So now I ask you, as a member of Christ Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? If so, say, I will. And as a member of Memorial United Methodist Church, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service? If so, say, I will. Let's welcome our newest members to Memorial United. Great. I'll let you have those. Thank you so much. Congratulations. Welcome. You all can head down this way and be careful. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sins, and seek to live in peace with God and one another. Therefore, let us now confess our sins before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we've not always loved you as we ought. Our love has at times been distorted. We have not loved our neighbor as fully human, and we have not always loved you the way that a bride loves her husband. And so we ask for forgiveness. We pray for your mercy, and we pray that you may restore us and redeem us and work within us that we, like Eliana, may grow to be faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Amen? Amen. At this time, we're going to give of our tithes and our offerings. As we do, you can give in the offering plate, you can text your offering, or you can go to our website, memorialumc.church. Let's stand as we sing and give our gifts to God.
stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. I'm standing in your love.
If you're able, please remain standing for great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let's pray. Almighty God, we lift up our hearts to you and we give thanks to you. For you created us in your image. You breathed into us the breath of life. You made us a people of love. And for that, we're thankful. We're thankful for the ways that you have remained, that your love has remained steadfast even when our love failed. The way you gave us the gift of the law, the way you spoke to us, the prophet, through the prophets. And for that, we are grateful. And so we join with angels and all the company of heaven and all the saints who have gone before us and the church around the world in singing, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick. He ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. And so we give you thanks that on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this as often as you eat it in remembrance of me. Likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. And now, let us pray the prayer our Lord taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. I invite those who are assisting me to come forward at this time. You may be seated. Today we'll receive communion by intinction. That means you'll come forward, you'll receive a piece of the bread, you'll take a step to the outside and gently dip that into the cup, and then you can make your way back around the sides to your seat. In the United Methodist Church, we have an open table. That means regardless of where your tradition, what Christian tradition you come from, we recognize your baptism, and you are welcome to eat here, for this is not our table, but this is the Lord's table, and we hope you will come. You'll be directed forward by an usher. The feast is set. Won't you come to the feast? The body of Christ given for you.
Ooh.
shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. 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 Amen.
God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you've given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of our spirit, of your spirit, to give ourselves for others. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
The God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God. quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. We shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung up on that cross, then he rose up from that grave. My God's still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. We shout out your praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. 'Cause we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. We shout out your praise. Praise. Oh, oh, oh. We shout out your praise. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We shout out your praise.
Got a pastor, Chris. You got something over there.
Yes, there we go. A few announcements as we send you out this week. First, Pub Theology is this Thursday at 7 o'clock at 102 Tap House. If you want to talk about current issues and how they intersect with our faith, it's a great opportunity. Let me know if you're planning to attend. And then believe it or not, next Sunday we begin Holy Week. It's Palm Sunday. And then on Thursday, Maundy Thursday, we'll have a noontime foot washing service here in the fellowship hall. And then at 7 p.m., we'll have our Maundy Thursday service in the sanctuary. And on Friday, we'll have a tenebrae service for Good Friday, also in the sanctuary at 7 p.m. And then, of course, Easter Sunday, we'll be here gathered together. And right after this service, at about 10:15-ish, we'll have an Easter egg hunt out on the lawn right outside the doors here between the church and the parsonage. So bring your kids and grandkids and some baskets. I've been told that the youth will not put empty wrappers in the eggs this year. So we'll see. And finally, Methodist 101 will begin right after Easter, on the Wednesday after Easter, 6:30 to 8 o'clock. If you've ever wondered why we do what we do, why we believe what we do, it's a great opportunity to come and learn. So I invite you to join us after Easter.
This next weekend also, we will be taking, there are 16 of us with the youth group who are going to Winter Jam. big Christian concert in St. Louis, so we ask for your prayers for safety. It's a big event and a long day. We also will be kicking off our mini mission week. So next week, the youth group will be doing several mini mission projects throughout Farmington, and so you might see us out and about through town.
Thank you, Casey. And we're not going to sing because I'm late, but it's her birthday today. Now go forth from this place to love others as a full human and to love God with your heart, mind, soul, and strength. In the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace.
There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord.